the overall aim of the IMAGEMEND project, Imaging Genetic for Mental Disorders, is to help to improve clinical management for psychiatric disorders by providing tools for better prediction and diagnosis. Imaging genetic means, in a narrow sense, finding the connection between the genetic underpinning of an individual and the brain function, brain structures. And this will help to better understand how changes in the genes and in the brain are correlated to psychiatric disorder or symptoms of psychiatric disorder, and a better understanding and also a better than diagnosis, how to tie the symptom together to a whole diagnosis and to the cause of disorder. Human behavior and thinking and feeling is very broad, and so it can be that many of the symptoms we see will not be reflected neither by this correlation between genes and brain functioning. On the other hand, I'm pretty convinced that the severe disorders like schizophrenia and autism, ADHD, bipolar disorder do have a correlate, and identifying these correlates and target were to provide medication will help in identification of reasons and preventing disorders and better diagnosis. We ask experts, experts means patient, relatives, but also psychiatric geneticists and so on, about their opinions and meaning, to be a little bit outside of the mainstream, but to really grasp also hesitation, anxiety, different thoughts surrounding genetic testing, because this is always in complex disorder about risk, and risk can be taken very differently depending on the personality of the person, the circumstances, and so that a doctor should have the chance to check all these different viewpoints, we developed this short checklist.
Genetic testing in psychiatric disorders is more sensitive for several reasons. One is that it's more complex, it's likely many, many genes involved for each disorder. It's also more sensitive because it's kind of stigmatizing, and also because there is a very high comorbidity between different psychiatric disorders. So it's hard to find genetic predictors that are precise enough. This is a field which is very timely, I would say, as the population today knows much more of genetics than they did before, and they are also asking more frequently about the results of the testing. That's my experience from my research projects. But the right to know is always there. The right not to know is maybe more difficult, because if we find something special, the doctor, especially in a clinical research, might want to help the patient by giving some additional data, especially for very unusual disorders. So my answer on your question is, it will be probably in the future, it will be much more common that people ask for it and they are giving secondary findings. But today, the level of knowledge is a bit meager. We are not there yet. If we find an unusual mutation that we know with the high probability will give psychiatric symptoms or other symptoms that will affect the person's life in a major way, then I think it is our responsibility to tell them. We are talking about risks. I mean, even genetic data is about risks, and it's not 100%. We have many other factors that might affect a person's risk to get, for instance, schizophrenia or ADHD. So considering that the risk is not 100%, you have to be, I would hesitate in many situations where the risks are lower, because people, it's also hard for people to understand risks. And usually they magnify them and think that their risks are much more, are higher than they really are. In fact, we have that sentence in the informed consent that if we find something, would you like to know more about it? So, the ratio, I think it's about at least 70% to say that they want to know.
When you don't integrate miners in a clinical study, then you avoid improvements, achievements in new medical treatments. Therefore, it's a necessity to include miners in clinical trials. But they are a very vulnerable group, and therefore you need certain kind of requirements to meet the needs of miners. And that means for the informed consent process, for example, that you really adapt the methodologies on the stage of maturity to minors.
Of course, the involvement, it's different in different age groups. So when you ask the opinion, when from the very small child, you need to have good information, pictures and additional visual information to give the information. But when they are grown-ups and adolescents, they understand more and they can give their independent opinions.
I think minors perceive burdens and risks in a completely different way than adults do. So, for example, an MRT might be for them a great risk, a great burden because of the noise, because of the very close situation in the instrument. And we need to listen to the miners, and miners who have participated in a clinical trial could be very much a consultant or an advisor for those who design clinical studies.
It's really important to involve children into the process all the way from beginning, from the designing the trials, and especially when you design the documents for the trials for informed consent and assents, you need to have and hear opinion from the children, how they would like to see the information, how they understand it, and in what format they want to be presented to them. So it's really important that now they are young persons advisory groups and so on, who can take part even before the trial starts. They can give their opinion what is the best way to do the trial, also the procedures, but also the documents, how they are understood.